Hello, and a very good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you, depending on whichever part of the globe you're logging in from. Welcome, everyone. A warm welcome to those who will be watching us live today and to those who will be viewing the replay of the session on social media. I see that people have started logging in. My name is Omar Sharif. I am a student of life. I love to learn, share, and contribute towards enriching lives and making the world a better place to live in. Impacting lives is my passion, and I work with people to enable them to become a better version of themselves. Now, as promised, we are back to share knowledge, provide insights, and listen to stories of wisdom from a very special guest today. Today, as usual, we're live with multiple platforms, including YouTube and Facebook. And as we progress through the session today, please feel free to punch in your questions or comments in the chat box. We would love to hear from you. The application I'm using, StreamYard, you've got to give it permission. And as I could see your comment, I could highlight your comment on the screen so we can interact with you as well. Of course, not live on camera, but we can talk to you and you can ask us questions through the chat box, okay? Ladies and gentlemen, today we have Patrick Bensen in our studio, who is both an organizational coach, organizational psychologist rather, and a behavioral clinical psychologist. Patrick, welcome to the show. An absolute honor to have you.
Me too. I'm honored to be here too.
Great. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Patrick is the director of Leaders of Tomorrow Institute at PB Consulting Limited. He's a member of the Council of Forbes Business Council, Entrepreneur Magazine, and Harvard Business Review. Patrick has consultation rights at the United Nations and is an expert at the European Commission. His specialties include workplace redesign, change management, organizational culture, HR consulting, amongst others. Apart from being a member, he is a member of many, many associations. To name a few, he's a member of Canadian Psychological Association, American Psychological Association, Thai Clinic Psychology Association, which is where he's based right now. And he's also a Canadian Counseling and Psychotherapy Association member. Patrick is also an expert on the EU Commission's board. Patrick, proud to have you here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It sounds a very pompous, all this title or thing, but you know, I don't use all of them every day. But yes, it's good to be recognized by some great institution like the European Commission, for example.
As humble as you could be. Great. Welcome again. An absolute gratitude to you for sharing your time with us. We'll jump in straight into the conversation. I'm sure the audience who's logging in from Philippines, from Singapore, from India, Pakistan, UAE, and some other countries in the GCC as well, including Egypt, the Middle East, we have a lot to learn from you today. I follow you. Patrick says hello to everybody. I do see Conan who's online, Fiola and Fazila. Hello, everybody. And a lot of the people who have still not commented, feel free to do that whenever you can, and feel free to ask questions as we move forward. So, Patrick, I have read some of your writings and your recent articles on Forbes Business Council on learning to live with what life throws at us literally threw me off. To say I was dumbfounded with that article would be an understatement. I loved it. Very, very logical, very, very well written. In that article, you do mention yourself and reference yourself as an organizational psychologist and draw an analogy between life and a sailboat. Would love to have an elaboration from you on that.
Yes. Well, I love the sea. I always grew up by the sea. So, you know, it was a reflection that I had, like, are we different species really altogether, or are we like the fish, you know, that seems they haven't really learned how to, we've been fishing for as long as we've been human almost. And so the fish have been caught by us for all the same amount of time. Now, every animal on this planet have learned to be deviant of us, like the bear, for example, or the wolf. They don't go straight at us. They're trying to hide from us. Any animals will be shy. The fish, however, go still biting on the same hook that was used 10,000 years ago or more, and the same manners without knowing. So I was thinking, okay, are we, and I'm not mocking the fish here, but I'm mocking ourselves, saying like, we had a pandemic coming, but it's not the first time we have a fear coming. We had wars for as long as we can remember. We have pandemic. We have the Spanish flu. I mean, killed 50 million people less than 100 years ago. Just in Europe only. The Black Plague killed half population of Europe. Whatever the population was, it was 50%. They died on their feet within 1 year. It's not the first time we go through things that are in nursery. However, it's the first time the fear is total. Is globally. It's also the first time we have a, because in the Spanish flu long time ago, they didn't have internet. So you could hear about it, but if you were very far away, then it didn't concern you. Maybe you never heard of it. But now with the spread of the news, the fear spread out like fires on the prairies. It really did. And I think we, partly it's true, I'm not saying the COVID is not dangerous or we shouldn't be afraid of it or whatever. What I'm saying is like the fear is 50% of what's happening to us, I think. And as a clinical psychologist, I'm not so here to talk about the validation of the COVID and how to fight the COVID, because this will be another department I'm not so sure about. However, what I can talk about is the fear that has created us and how to tackle those fear. So this article is about, when are we going to learn to live with whatever life threw at us? When are we going to learn to accept that life is dangerous? That every time you cross the street, you know, every time you get out of your bed, you know, anything can happen. And it's not just running away by a car. It could be any kind of things. And you cannot soundproof life. You cannot just like make it safe. Life is, it's but safe. It's everything but safe. And there's two ways to go by it. Either we accept that is not safe, and we cope with it. We develop coping mechanism. And I like you to take the pirate ship. Like you in the old days when we were like, you know, the free mass boats, and you have to learn how to sail and to trust other. The ship can be steered by one person. It has to be a team. There's no other way to get, if not, you get even out of the port. There was no engine to push it out or push it back or anything, only the wind. So you have to know some skills, and you have to be able to go in whatever the seas throw at you, whatever the weather. You cannot say, I only can take the sea if it's blue sky with a nice wind on the back by about 20 knots, because that would never happen, maybe once a year. What you have to is to learn to go with any kind of weather. And that joined like a very old Chinese proverb that say about that, like, don't worry about the sea, he says. He says, worry about be a good swimmer. If you become a good swimmer, then you won't be afraid of being thrown overboard by the storm. You can climb up your ship, and then you can carry on thing. This is what you should learn. You want to be a sailor? Learn to swim. And eventually learn to play with the wind. But you cannot learn how to control the weather. Even if you learn about the weather, you cannot control it. So that was a reflection on my article to finish with that, you know, we have to eventually, there's no other way, we have to learn to live with whatever life throw at us, good or bad. And that's how we become a better species altogether.
So we essentially have to adapt. And regardless of what life keeps throwing at us, we've got to adapt and take it head on and learn to live with it rather than committing the same mistake over and over again.
For example, like I take the polar bear. I love polar bears. They've been living for 10,000 years in the polar area of the world, and they have learned to adapt to this environment. Their skin, their colors, they can hide because that's why they're white, because everything is white around them. If they were black, it was spotted by any enemies. So they become white as the snow. They can dig, they can do whatever they want. Now the snow is disappearing very fast, sadly. Whoever bear, a bear is a bear, it can eat anything. If the bear moves south and learn to eat mushrooms and vegetables, those bears, like the counterpart bear, the black bear or the brown bear that eats other things, then they will survive after moving from the pole area to more southern region. Now, the question is like, how fast can they adapt? If they're not fast enough, they will all dead, like within a few years, because the snow is done. And they're depending on the snow at the moment. Now, if they just, somebody could tell the polar bear, move south, mushroom is also nice, and apple and fruit. You can live on it, absolutely. Because you, your cousin, the other bear, they live on it for thousands of years. And you too, you could. So this is adaptation. It's no longer, we have to think, not only, I like to say, we don't think outside the box anymore. We think outside the building, because there's no more building, even for the workplace psychology. The workplace has changed, right? So don't think outside the box in your building. Just forget the building and think, that's it.
I absolutely agree. Very, very well said and very, very well articulated as well. You know, time and again, we've been tutored. As I was growing up, I was tutored also the same way, where teachers taught us to prepare for the worst, prepare for the worst and expect the best, right? Hope for the best, rather. So it was always hope for the best, prepare for the worst. But I see that you also challenge that in your article, because you say the reptilian brain gets confused because we're not used to conflicting ideas, right? And so could you just elaborate on that too as well, please?
Just, and without being a lecture here, but we have three brains, just for those who didn't know about that. We have three brains that will build on top of each other as our human evolution. When we start as reptilian, whatever you believe, that's the truth. That's the scientific truth. We have a very small in the core of a brain, the size of a reptilian brain, because we were first reptilian. And then we become mammal, like the bear, or like any mammals. And then on top of that, we become Homo sapiens. So we have three bears. The biggest one is the Homo sapiens. And then we have the mammal bear, and the bear, the bear brain, we call it, and the reptilian brain at the core. However, the brain doesn't make any difference. It was built on top of each other. So whatever you handle from, we don't know which part of the brain handle, as long as you handle the information. Now, it's very noticeable to know that 60% of decision come from the reptilian brain still. So we think we're very clever because we have a smartphone, because we have thing, we have a computer. Now we're talking in distance, and we think we went to the moon and soon to Mars. Yes, we did all that with the reptilian brain, 60% of decision, which is the reptilian brain is yes, no, hot, cold, flee or fly. We have this kind of thing. That's exactly the response we have on the pandemic. Fear. That's reptilian brain. Now, you can use the other part of the brain. So the mammal brain would be more like compassion. You know, we have compassion for other kind of other things. This is a compassion. This is the mammal brain and other things. And the parental. And of course, the Homo sapiens brain, what is good for? It's good for analytic and thinking. That's how we send the guy to the moon, with the analytic, with changing things. Why don't we use that instead of using the reptilian brain 60%? And it's possible to, by concentrating, move a little bit, the shift in what we use. We have no proper, we cannot control exactly, but we know now we can shift from reptilian brain to other part of the brain using, depending on the emotion you're having. So when we have this kind of fight or flee situation, breathe 5 seconds, close your eyes, breathe, and see if it's really that dangerous. Then other part of the brain will kick in and other thoughts will come in. And then you reply other idea instead of just fighting or fleeing. So yes, absolutely. Prepare for this is American way and many other ways. Prepare for the worst and hope for the best. If you do that, you always ready for the worst part of your life, hoping it will not come. That means you completely set up your life for the worst part. You're ready to fight all the time. You stress on top of the daily life, which is stressful enough. The stress is not only in your head, it's like all over your body and your organs and everything. You prepare yourself to fight. And when, like for impact, we know now that when we're crashing a car, and by accident, in the few seconds that thing, knowing you're going to crash, the body prepare for that, the organ intensify, they get ready the best they can for the crash. because they want to be hard as possible. If they were soft, then they will be smashed completely. So your heart, your stomachs, your everything is, it's your tones, your muscles prepare for the impact within a fraction of a second. You're super tense, super tense. If you have, if it's an accident that you can still get out of the car, you super tense. It would take hours to relax because that 1 second prepared for the impact have intensified you, all of your body so hardly that it would take hours to go back to normal. Yeah. Now imagine if you do that every day, 24/7, when are you going to relax?
I absolutely agree. Goodness, now that he's mentioned it, all my NLP practitioner learnings are coming to my mind, where you mentioned prepare for the worst. And when you prepare your mind and your body to prepare for the worst, really, you are in one way or the other, not just harming yourself, you are also attracting the worst.
That's right.
You know, in one way or the other. So that's, but so
you're making
thank you for challenging that. I think that's a whole new perspective on that idiom we've been hearing since childhood. So you don't need to prepare for the worst.
You see, I like to compare some education system. It starts with education. I like to compare the education system, for example, of Norway, which I'm an Norwegian descent, and I love Norway for that. And I compare with the French, and I'm not trying to put one against each other. So please, if there's Norwegian listening or French listening, I'm not against each other. But it's two completely different way of thinking that can be validated. Both can have a value behind it. I understand why both do that, but it's the opposite. So the French says, life is hard. The Norwegian says, I agree, life could be hard. The French say, well, if it's hard, let's prepare our kids as soon as possible to face the worst. We have to educate them as soon as possible. We have to prepare them for what life can bring to them. And the Norwegian says, you're absolutely right. Life is as hard as we agree, 100%. Let them be kids for as long as possible because they will eventually find the problem.
Very, very, very great perspectives again, right? So two different, same problem. And yes. Two different perspectives, and the entire scenario changes. You bring up your kids, your children, in a very, very different manner, and both of them grow up to be different human beings.
Totally. You know, like in Iceland, which is, you know, country we never talk about. In Iceland, at the end of the kindergarten day, they hug each other. So every day they hug a new colleagues. They're 5, 6 years old, and they hug. What is important? They hug for 5 minutes. It's not just it's not the what I call the English hug, the tap on the don't tap me. Don't tap me. You know, when I say hug me, but don't tap me. And hug me significantly. That means like make the bound, the connection between the human being. Not an accolade. So it's not an accolade. It's a real hug. So the kids in Iceland hugs for 5 minutes because it takes a bit that long because it's awkward, you know, and when your kids less, when you adult a bit more. But you hug for 5 minutes until something happening in the chemistry there, in the what we call the torus that's surrounding us, the energy field that is surrounding us. And then they look at each other and they say something like, thank you that you are in my life. So when you grew up this way, you meet a new person, wherever they come from, in that openness. You know, if you don't do that, if you're scared of, like, you know, scared of touch, and with the pandemic, we don't live in a touching world already. Eh? I mean, some cultures still touch, but we, generally speaking, we don't live in a between religions and politics and traditions and whatever. We don't really touch each other, you know. The touching time, the bonding time, is only for kids and his mother, maybe a little with the father, with the hug and things. And then rapidly, the teenager will learn, oh, they don't touch me. We're embarrassing myself, or he's not allowed, or he's not permitted anymore between men and women, whatever the case. However, forget all that. We are human, and we are survived because of the bonding. We need to be touched. And we need Correct. To touch other. Touching means a hug is a touch. That's this kind of touching I'm talking about. being close to each other because we need to Descartes says, like, the only way to learn is to be surrounded by bright mind, you know, and you don't have to touch them. But if you were in a room with Einstein and all the Copernicus and all these people, you will be bubbled inside, because all this brain, even if you're not that smart, you will be motivated to be, because the energy these people just have in the room will push you forward.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you also bring up a very good point about hugging and touching. Humans generally need that warmth, right? And I remember the time when someone told me oxytocin as a hormone gets released in your body because of the fact of feeling loved and feeling acknowledged. And I think that just says it all in terms of how important the well-being becomes when it comes to really having the warmth of people around you.
So you know what happened? Because we don't touch anymore, but we still need oxytocin, as you just mentioned. They get it on something else, social media or playing video games. The satisfaction of being liked with one like, we don't even know who like you, it doesn't matter, but you get one more count, and that's for 1 second make you feel better. And that's, you know, for 1 second, that's it. And you get nothing out of it. Or playing a game where you can master the game or whatever you do. So people have replaced the human connection with another way to get oxytocin. And I'm talking about drugs and alcohol here, another thing, because that's another thing altogether. But new generation, and with the social media, unfortunately, without saying any name, I got the wrong clients right now that spend 21 hours on social media per day. 21 hours out of 24. That means sleep 3 hours and again put himself on his phone. And that's very sad.
Yeah. Well,
no time to get out.
Yeah, I totally agree. You know, just circling back again to the point where you mentioned about this conflict in the mind and the cognitive dissonance, which gets created in ourselves because of things what we just talked about. There's also an often repeated concept where you keep hearing time and again, and that is work-life balance. Mm-hmm. And work-life balance and all the issues we seem to be facing because of the imbalance at best right now, you blame it on COVID, you blame it on work pressure, you blame it on productivity increase, whatever it is. But research has consistently shown that a healthy work-life balance is vital for maintaining a job satisfaction and avoiding burnout. However, and you can correct me on this, a new study suggests that the idea of work-life balance in itself may be a problem. The standard concept of work-life balance is often seen as a zero-sum game, where work and life are completely separate domains, you know, that are constantly competing for the time and energy of the person. And looks like that term is now being replaced with work-life harmony, where we don't necessarily need to draw an impermeable border between work and life, and we can actually merge them together, but we need to learn how to do that. What's your perspective on that?
Perfect. You nail it. Thank you so much for saying that. People forget work-life balance. Work-life, you can keep. Forget balance. A balance on a scale, we know that if you put more on this one, you have less on the other one. That's what balance is all about. So if I have more work, I have less life. If I put more life, I have less work. That's what he implied. That's wrong. It is again a choice. It's not about a choice between work and life, trying to sometimes make more. It's both, especially now when working from home. So forget the word balance and put the word harmonization. Mm-hmm. It's the work-life harmonization that we need to do, not the work-life balance. Because a balance means exactly what it means. If you have more of this, you have less of the other one, and it's not what you want. You need both. So at the same time, all the time. And now it's possible even more because of what's happening. In a way, COVID, I mean, as always, it's good and bad. You know, it's the way, depending on you view the glass, the half empty of half full. For the workplace, COVID is the best news that happened to us in 100 years. For the workplace. Because he has forced the management to think differently. He has forced the employee to think their work-life harmonization differently. He has proven that, yes, we can work from home. We don't have to go 3 hours each way on traffic jam to go to work and come back. And he has removed the symbol of the big name tower then we don't need anymore. That is very, very primitive way of the big IBM tower or the big Google tower. Google and Amazon have actually given up the tower because they have permitted their employee to be permanently for the rest of their life from home. So who wants to get a tower? And who is going to be able to rent the tower that Amazon was renting in Seattle? Who has this money? No one else. So the towers will be empty forever. They're going to bring an apartment inside, I hope, hopefully. You know, they need more apartments than they need. But the second wave, so once you find a life harmonization, what does it mean today? Because it's not only what we are today, it's also what kind of generation we're talking about. The workplace is not one kind of people, it's many generations altogether. And the young, from generation the millennium and from generation Z coming after them, more so than us, they want to have the normalization. They want to do yoga in the morning, work early, at noon. They want to take a very like subtle lunch at 2, and they want to go to the beach and play soccer or football a bit later, and they want to go back to work at night when it's quiet. Mm-hmm. That's how they want to live their life. Not, and so the 8 to 5 things doesn't fit them at all. And the 3 hours to go to work and the 3 hours to go back. So you start at 5 in the morning, just to arrive at 8, and you finish at 6 or 7, and you arrive at 10, you go straight to bed without taking your shoes off. They don't want that life. And I don't blame them, because sadly, I was doing a bit of that for a while. And who wants that? Not even me. So they want all together. If they don't have to go to work ever, you have to think, would they want to stay in a very overpriced city? For example, I take San Francisco in the Silicon Valley. They were there because the Silicon Valley was there. There's no other place. If you want to work at the Silicon Valley, you have to be by the Silicon Valley. So San Francisco to San Jose. And I lived there for a while because I worked for Apple Incorporation, actually there. But it's nice, but I mean, you don't see them nice because you're always, working or in traffic. So you don't realize where you are anymore. Now, if you don't have to go to work anymore, ever, at this office, why should I stay 5 miles away from the office in still overpriced city? Then I'm going to go to another state, or I'm going to pack all my family all together and go to another place where it's nicer, where I can maybe do yoga in the morning with a real master yoga, and I'm going to move to Thailand working for the Silicon Valley. And I think this is the next step after COVID and the thing, and when people realize that we don't need to go so much, not everyone, but for the majority of us, we don't need to go at work, then the people are going to start to balance out the offer. That means overpriced city is going to be less overpriced because people will be leaving them. The use of cars will be less, and it will be electric cars. It will be actually, it's all a good news, I see, for the environment and for life altogether. So yeah, life harmonization, life work harmonization is on the way, is a big thing, and is not about to be a trend. That's it. Those who don't understand that, those who want to go back to the Monday morning meeting in my office on the 70th floor of the tower, they'd be alone there waiting.
Yeah, very well said. And I think you're right when you point out work from home is not just a trend, it's actually here to stay. Even if things go back to normal, and people really get back into the infrastructure and the buildings that they had occupied with the big brand names on those facades, I guess it's always going to be a hybrid kind of a work function where some people who are necessarily needed in office might go to office, and those who are not will still be working from home. But having said that, you pointed out a very, very nice, wonderful macro view of how COVID-19 has enabled to take the economy and the way we work in the right direction, where people do not need to necessarily stay near their office. They can, of course, go and live in the suburbs, go and live in Thailand, go and live in elsewhere, and still work, because it's not work from home, it's work from anywhere nowadays.
That's right.
But having said that, given the fact that a majority of employees have been enforced to work from home, and from what I've seen and when I talk to people, I get mixed reactions from organizations about increased or decreased productivity. Looks like the employees have been enforced to work from home, but they're not necessarily very, very acceptable to it. The borders between home and work got completely eliminated. Now look at it this way. I kind of, you're a psychologist, you would be able to guide me in a much more defined manner. But the way I look at it, pre-COVID, we all played multiple roles in organizations, right? We wore one hat and then took it off, wore another hat before we went to do the next meeting. So for a person working in a corporate office, moving from one meeting room to another, just walking down from one meeting room to another, was a transition for him to get into the mood, settle in, and really respond very proactively and productively. For a person like me, who travels a lot, it was all about getting on an international flight and moving from one market to another for my next meeting. But now, post-COVID, all that has been put to a full stop, and suddenly you find yourselves jumping from one Zoom meeting to the next, one Microsoft Teams meeting to the next, without being able to catch your breath, and you start clicking in trying to get logged in. And this, I feel, has also been causing a kind of a fade out or a burnout. And it doesn't stop here. And correct me if I'm wrong again, I noticed the meta audience, you know, the families who have always seen the person working, have always seen your working self go to office, come back in the evening, be with the family, have suddenly started looking at your working self at work and reacting in ways which you never probably could have done in front of them. And more often than not, I find the working roles kind of getting, you know, protruded or projected in the family decision-making and the family roles as well. Now, my question to you would be, given all this as a picture, what should be the course of action for employees who are working from home to ensure the work-home harmonization does not get ruptured and it actually becomes productive for them, not just for them, for the company, for them and the families too?
Well, we are in transition, for sure. You know, it's referring to what we were talking about in early this conversation, life is change, but for some reason we don't go well with change. We don't want to change. Now, by force, it has changed. It will take time for us to adapt to whatever it is.
Right.
Home was never seen as a workplace. It was home. It was separate from the workplace. Now, we're blending those limits together. Not everyone lives in a mansion with 65 rooms, and they can use two or three, just one to sleep, one to work, and one to go to one meeting to the others, by having computers in every room and changing the setting behind them. Some of them live all together with their grandparents and things, and they have to manage the kids and the grandparents and the things, you know, at the only table there is in the living room. That is not easy. I'm lucky I got my office, but I couldn't work from home. I tried working from home and I couldn't. So I took an office. So yes, it requires some adaptation and it would take a while to get there. I'm not sure, and yes, you're right, it has been at the moment, because we don't know how, it's been an increase of burnout. Because we don't want to do the job, not the right time to do the job. So we try to impress the boss even more. The boss doesn't know how to lead us anymore because the Monday morning meeting and it's gone too. So he doesn't have a time to ring every employee. I mean, I've got one, I'm talking to Google in India and they have 55,000 employees. Imagine the boss ringing 55,000 employees every day to see, check how they're doing. Even if it takes 1 second, it would take 5 weeks. Just to ring them and 1 second each. It's not possible. So without a guidance, without a peer, without the, you have your colleague at work, you know, if you didn't feel that good on Monday morning or Tuesday, people say, oh, you don't feel so good today. It was a bit, now no one knows except those we're talking on Skype or whatever the media you use. So the management has to be changed, and the way to relate to the management and to report how you're doing, not only for work, but how you're doing as yourself, you know, has to be changed. The way reporting, we're building as we're in the making. Now, blending your personal life, family life with work nonstop, that will not gonna work, because your family shouldn't be responsible. I mean, it's, you know, they shouldn't be sharing that much of your time. You know, when I go home, my little girl wants to play with me. It doesn't matter how much hard I play with it. She didn't see me the whole day. When I go home, it's my time. That's the way she understands. You hear now? It's my time. You know, and she said, I'm not tired yet. Tired? Because I'm not tired. Let's play. And I don't blame her. And because that's the thing. And so blending those two, trying to make understand a 5 years old that no, you already work and you cannot play with her, she gets sad only. The only thing you can give is sadness, not time. So yes, we need to have the time. That's the harmonization we need to do. Working from home won't do that, especially if you have a small little home with family or multi-generation, even worse. So we need to adapt to this, not only the technology has to adapt to this, but also the way we deal with it and the management. Everything has to change, not only us. Or at the moment, because we haven't find the balance or find the harmonization, we get very stressed out. It's everything we don't like. It's new. He has to work right now. We don't know how. We don't have the technology. We haven't figured out all these things. We haven't figured out how to feed the 5 kids that are crying at the background and then saying, shh, I'm talking, it's very important meeting, you know, and you cannot shut up a baby crying. You cannot. So then your wife go to the other room and then, but doesn't like that. How long is the meeting? How many do you have a day? You know, how long they have to be hiding from you? So we have to find all that, this harmonization that we've done. And I personally reckon that working from home, like from home, you have to make a change in your home to allow that you have your free time, because your family shouldn't be right in the middle of your business meeting.
Agree. In fact, we have an audience member, Sadia, who says, I've worked remotely for the past 15 years and takes extreme self-discipline with family congruency simultaneously. Sadia is an American citizen. She's now based in Dubai, and she works as an editor as well. And she does a lot of other things in terms of tasting food in various restaurants. She is very, very intellectual. I can relate with that too. I have been working from home for the past 9 years, and I love every bit of it, frankly. I enjoyed COVID-19. When COVID-19 hit and many people were forced to work from home, I was actually working as a coach, advising them as to what should be done, what should not be done. But frankly, my findings were that everybody is different. Everybody's organization is different. I can vouch for it because I work for a company, a manufacturer, an American organization, which is one of the best organizations in the world, you know, in terms of taking care of its employees. I remember the time when COVID-19 hit and we were into a lockdown. My boss, who's the vice president of the company, used to call me up every week and talk to me, asking for the well-being of the family rather than work. They were not concerned about business and work. They were more concerned about me and my family. Now, obviously, not every organization does that, but I wish every organization could be like mine. But if you have a company like that, if you work for people like those, I think that's when things become much more easier. Otherwise, kind of becomes a little difficult.
And I want to say to Sadia, thank you for sharing. And also, it sounds like you're a very strong person and you have a self-discipline. And sadly, not everyone is built the same. And not everyone have a self-discipline as you have. And congrats to have been working and make it work family-wise and work-life 15 years and counting. That's an achievement. And you are the leader, because like not everyone work from home. And now suddenly you become you could teach many people how to do that, Sadia. So thank you for sharing. But as I say, it would take, some people need to be told what to do. That's, you know, right. Some people need to say, I'm done, what next? I'm done, what next? And they can't find what's next by themselves. Some people, they need that. Some people, they might not need that, but they need to have like a timeline or time frame to work with. It's not, they get so distracted that they forget to go back to what they were doing. And then, you know, become a mess, because then it's piling up. Self-discipline is great if you have that to start with, and you can learn self-discipline. I'm not saying you cannot learn, but with 7.7 billion people on this planet, not everyone has self-discipline, and I knew that already. So it has to be, for those who have that, great. For those who don't have that, to find another way. With so many people on this planet, we're all different, which is unique, which is challenging and beautiful at the same time. And how we blend all this thing, you know?
True. Looks like your inputs are being loved by the audience. We have a gentleman here, Conan Shahidi, who says, work or home, emotion matters. When you have the tools to harness the power of emotions, you can build energized, engaged, and productive teams. If not, emotions will manage your interactions, your work groups, and its output. Very, very well said.
Yep, well said.
And we have we have this lady from Egypt. Mariam is based in Egypt, and I know her very well. She's one of those very fierce. She's an engineer by profession and a very fierce businesswoman. And she says, a year from yesterday, I started to work from home. It's been a year, goodness gracious.
Yeah.
It ends up working more, but I feel that I'm trapped here. Have no time to go to the gym for a month after being there twice a day. Yeah, you know, I can relate to that too.
But so, I mean, yes, that's exactly it. It's like every time there's a change, you have to, it would be some, you know, maybe you wouldn't have time to go to the gym twice a day. Or you have to take your work at the gym, or the gym has to go to the home. I mean, I don't know. you know, I mean, something like that. If you really, if gym, for example, Mariam is for you, it's very important to go to the gym. By all means, there's nothing wrong with that. But if you need twice a day, it's quite a bit. People go twice a month usually. You go twice a day. Well, you know, that's a lot. Then you know, you probably, and there is, you know, tools and thing where you actually be on a treadmill, for example, and work at the same time. There is some desk where there's a treadmill on the bottom and there's a desk on the top. So you're actually walking as you're talking or working at the same time. It takes some quite coordination, but it's possible. I mean, for whatever it is, you know, there is solution, and more solution will come on this. For some, they want to sit on the beach and have just in a chair, a little thing, a cocktail or coconuts, and then they want to work from there because they concentrate better. It's the new coffee shop, and it's cheaper.
You know? Absolutely, absolutely. You know, I have been guilty. Well, I say guilty, but I think it's been a good thing. I have been on conference calls while working out. while working out at home, and that's been good. You know, as long as you are muted when the treadmill is running, you're fine.
When I got clinical psychology back to back, I do 5-6 clients one after the others. Well, I have to eat sometime. So when it comes to eat, you know, ice and whatever the clients, whatever the time, I say, look, I explain. They understand, they're human. I've been since this morning, I have to eat. If you don't mind, I'm still listening, but I'm eating at the same time. So it doesn't look too nice. I'm eating my soup at the same time or whatever, my noodles, but you know, but I'm trying to eat as, you know, as possible, but I'm still eating. And I allow them to do the same thing. And that's the thing, we need to allow. Right now, it's, you know, you have a shirt and you have a thing. I put a shirt on, and obviously, in my office, it's your office, and nice. But maybe one day the conference would be like we'd be, you know, in our pajamas and watching Netflix, and just switch off the sound 2 seconds and say, "Yeah, what's up?" You know, and we have to accept that, because you can always go back, run back to the office, and get dressed and things and shave and nice and say, "Okay, I'm ready for you." Okay, this is a new client, maybe, but if it's just a colleague of work, you find out, so how did you go today? You know, maybe I can tell you the same thing in my pajamas. But you have to accept, if you're my boss, to see me in my pajamas.
True that, true that. Yeah. And I think the world is changing. I think the acceptance at that level is kind of becoming the new normal now. Earlier, it would not have been a normal at all. But now it's kind of getting seeped in, and people understand it's okay to not be always dressed up when you're working from home.
Yeah, you have to accept that whatever the background. I mean, in many of those technical things, we can blur the background or change the background. Usually, right. I put the one on Zoom. I put the one in space. So I took a picture of the space, the International Space Station. And so when they say, "Where are you?" they don't worry, I see you from there.
Good one. I'll try that the next time.
Where are you? Don't worry. I'm around the globe 36 times a day, like a minute. So believe me, I see you wherever you are.
Exactly. So it's not WFH anymore. It's WFA, work from anywhere. It doesn't matter where you are.
Really, from space. And I mean that because you know that just in parenthesis, there's a rush to go to the moon, back to the moon this time to establish a colony, only to see how we survive, to go to the next step, to go to Mars. That is to be the high priority for some agency or many space agency. Moon and Mars, from the Chinese, from the Indian government, from the American government, from the European government, and the Russians, they all want to go to Mars. Mars is a new space to be. They can go without me. Parenthesis, I stay in Thailand with my coconuts. But if you want to go to Mars, by all means, knock yourself out. But those will be there, working remote. You're talking remote here. Can you come to my office? Maybe take 2 years. Yeah, next time the planet aligns, I will take the next shuttle.
Love that. Okay, Conan also has a bit of a wisdom here. The last couple of lines, he says, rest is very important and time off is certainly critical, especially when you're working from home. And I think I salute that. I think that's true, absolutely. And you have to understand where you don't let the lines get totally blurred and ensure that you take your time off when you can and rest as well, or reset as well, rather.
Very, very well said. And I want to say something about sleeping, because before you get to burnout, you get chronic stress. Before you get chronic stress, you get stress. And before you get stress, you get anxiety. And before you get anxiety, you lose your sleep. So the first sign of the way down, you all know it's going down south, like we say in Canada, because from Canada, you cannot go north. So we all say it's go down south, because from Canada, there's no north. We already north. So you already know you're on the way down when you lose your sleep. Now you sleep, and just like, again, on the technique, we're sleeping a third of our life, 25 years.
Yeah.
Like it or don't like it, that's the reality. About 25 years, we spend time sleeping. So 25 years, you wouldn't see anything. If we don't do that, however, there's only two things you cannot do for 3 days without dying. It's drinking water or drinking something, some liquid. Or for 3 days, you don't do that, you die after 3 days. And if you don't sleep, you also die. The brain at night with the five phases, actually three phases, but two intermittent phases. So three phases with two intermittent phases in between. It does, the brain, I call the team, the workers there, they're going to repair a lot of things. We have an average of 6,000 to 7,000 thoughts every day that have to be cleared out. Some will be there the next day. Some will be removed. Some, like I need to go to the bathroom, will be removed immediately after you've done that. But we have about 6,000 thoughts a day. And then if you don't clear it up, the next day will pile up to the next 6,000 and so on. You can imagine after a week how many thoughts if you don't sleep. And you can imagine after a month or two or years of not sleeping. Then you become a mess. You need to not only clear out the thought, that's one thing it does. You need to repair your body, because many things doing repair. And to do the most repair, it makes sure that you're just breathing. The heart is beating, the rest, I'm going to touch a part of the core of the brain that if we know, the team says, if we know you're going to wake up, it's too dangerous, we're not going there. So if you have a light sleep, even if you sleep, but you wake up every 2 or 3 hours, it won't be long enough for the deeper level of what we do in the sleeping, the 8 hour sleep we're supposed to do, to those repair. And after a while, you're losing it altogether. So sleeping means 8 hours. I don't care where you're from. I don't care what you look like. Are you human? Then it's 8 hours. That's it. It's not me saying it's like you can, you know. So yeah, but I only need 4. I only need 6. No. I read on a newspaper that the people that are very successful, they only sleep 4 hours. Who say that? Who come with this, sorry, BS, you know? So who come with that statement that you only need 4 hours? If Elon Musk only needs 4 hours, good for him. But that's one person. We need 8 hours. That's a statement. Because we need that long to repair the body. And if you don't do that, then you lose it altogether. So sleeping is super important. Resting is not sleeping. Sleeping is more efficient. But what about reintroducing something that the Spanish or some Latino country does, la siesta, those kind of break where they go to sleep, you know?
Afternoon siesta, right?
Yes. In Spain, for example, they're working from 8 to 12 and then they close from 12 to 4 p.m.
Right.
Don't go in Spain between midnight and between noon and 4. It's too hot. And so they close. They have adapted to the climate. It's maybe not maybe as hot as in Dubai, I don't know. But I mean, it's hot enough, especially south of Spain. So they close for 4 hours where the sun is the strongest. And they close their shutters and they eventually do a siesta. So, and then they work again from 4 to maybe 10 at night. Yep. At 10 at night, they go to eat and it seems like very late. But it's okay. And they start early. But they have this siesta that really change everything. In Italy, South Italy is the same, and in Turkey and in all these different countries. I don't know about Dubai and the Middle East, but they have this siesta that is very, very useful, actually. And why not? No working from home. No, nothing stop you to say, look, I don't work between noon and four. Why not? As long as they know. Don't disturb me.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's a great point. I remember when I first came to Dubai, I did notice a few companies here actually had that trend. Now, I don't think many companies do that. They used to shut down in the afternoon, not 12, but I guess 2 to 4 or 2 to 5, and then restart the working hours after 5 and go up to 8 or 8:30, I guess. But that's changed now. So, but it's I think it's a good habit if you can.
It's time to reintroduce that because we're from home anyway. So the siesta would be, you don't have to provide the bed to the employee. They're home already. So they can go to bed straight.
And especially when you're working with companies which are based in different time zones where you end up working late nights, I think that's definitely a necessity more than a luxury.
You know, if I was like the CEO of Google, of Amazon or things, I'm not, and I would never be. But if I was one of the big company, I hope they understand, or whatever the big company, banks or whatever. This is actually good news for them too. Because now they can employ anybody from anywhere at all the time zone. That means they have people working for them 24/7 without asking them to be 24/7 at the work. But your company is turning 24/7 because you have just different time zone. That means there's always somebody to answer your phone. There's always somebody to make the work. And the work is nonstop working without burning out your employee. This is actually good news.
Yeah.
Also, all the policies like, you know, I keep thinking of the American policy of protecting the borders and, you know, they don't want so many foreigners anymore. This is all gone in the wind because now you can work for Google from anywhere in the world and you forget the green cards, forget the application of things, forget Homeland Security because you still get a job and you stay in Pakistan.
True.
That's really good. And it's you know, it's for the best for most companies. If you remove the politics out of the equation, it's the best for the employee and it's the best for the company. Remove the pride. Remove the logo of the building. Remove the shirt that it says, I belong to. I don't belong to anyone. I belong to myself. And you remove that pride. Then it works. I think what we need to learn the next step is to remove the pride, not so much from the employee, but for the people that say, no, you need to have the brand and the things. And, you know, forget all that. Don't brand me. You want me to work? I work. Don't brand me. But the branding has been... It's been instilled in the culture, you know, that, I mean, some company like McDonald's, you eat McDonald's, you sweat McDonald's, you pee McDonald's, you dress McDonald's, you look McDonald's. Do you have to do all that to work with you? I have to look like a clown to work? Because let's face it, McDonald's is a clown. So I have to look like a clown to work there? Can I be myself and work there? So that's a question.
True, absolutely true. I agree with you. I know of an acquaintance who lives in New Jersey, and he's in IT. And recently when I met him, he said, I plan to move to Dubai. I said, why? I said, are you shifting a job? He said, no, I'm still working for the same company. I'll just move to Dubai with the family because it doesn't matter where I work from. It's IT. So whether he's in Dubai or in Thailand or in the US, working for an IT company in the US, it doesn't matter. The company is not bothered, least bothered, rather.
No, and you know what? And they're going to move too. If they really need an office, you know, knowing that they can also, the company can move. Do they have to pay taxes in this country? Maybe they're going to go where the, you know, so it's going to be a reshuffle of the cards of all the board because the people are going to move to cheaper place. The company you can do too. They already made. Absolutely. But I mean, they're going to carry on doing this because if you don't have to be there and there's no one coming to the office, then what's the point?
Absolutely. Patrick, circling back to making a life and employee well-being, we just touched upon a little earlier. News has it that the Berlin-based tech company Avin started to roll out a four-day work week to ensure well-being of the employees. Given the pandemic and number of us people were putting in working from home, they said, we'll not have a five-day work week anymore. We'll shift over to a four-day work week. And looks like the trend is catching up now in New Zealand, Spain, and even in Japan. And do you think that trend also is actually here to stay?
So, as always, what's new for some are very old news for some others. If you were Scandinavian, we've been doing this for the last 10,000 years. But is new for those who start yesterday. It's always new for those who start and very old for those who've been doing. So now what I'm talking about, Scandinavia have been doing this for quite some years, not 10,000. Mm-hmm.
40 work years. Week.
Yeah, yeah. And 6 hours a day. And 6 hours a day. Right?
So can I move there?
Denmark, for example, is like this, you know, for most, you know. So you can work more, but they have to pay more. So it means if you want to have a company operating 24/7, you need 3 teams. You cannot ask anymore because you'd be against the law. You don't have the money. It's, you know, I say to people, you want to drive a Porsche, by all means, if you can afford it. But if you don't have the money to buy a Porsche, you can buy another car. It's fine too. You don't have to drive a Porsche, you know. So you want to do whatever the business you want to do. First, no one forced you to do a business, okay? You cannot ask an employee to be there for you because he has other problems to sort it out. So there is this is something important, and maybe it looks like I'm going off track a little bit, but I'll come back to my track later. There is in the mentality of creating a business, I take as a pilgrimage, you know, whatever your religion is, as a pilgrimage. For the Muslim, they go to Mecca, you know, this at least one time in a lifetime, they have to go to Mecca. That's one thing. For the Christian, is to whatever. I mean, everyone has their own pilgrimage, you know, in their mind. The business has been, I compare the pilgrimage, which is the quest for the faith and to find God, which is, I could totally understand that. You know, which is supported by 98% of the population of Earth, whatever you believe in. That's a personal quest. That's my personal quest with God, whatever the name you give it. And doing a company. So there was a case in Vancouver of two brothers that want to do a restaurant. It was their dream. They create a restaurant. Yes, they had the money to open a restaurant. And they make the people work 24/7 without paying them because they couldn't afford to pay first. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, the people started to complain. They went to court, and the court ordered them to close the restaurant because they were doing more than overtime against the law, even in Canada. They didn't pay. That's completely against the law. Promising they will pay eventually, but when is eventually? After 3 months, people have to make a living. And the court ordered them to close down. And what is very important is like those brothers at the court cried and said to the judge, "You cannot do that to me, man. This is my dream." But yeah, but no one forced you to do that. It's your dream. Then do it by yourself and your brother. Fine. But don't involve somebody else in things. You have to understand why people work for you. So the company culture, and that's what I'm saying, like, you're trying to provide a good culture and sure, if there's some perk working for you, perk more than the salary and the position, and if there's some more perk, fine, great, I take it. Sure, I take it. But the main reason we're working is for ourselves. So you can brand it all you can. You can be in the best t-shirts, orange or green or whatever you want. You can. Me personally, I work for myself, first of all. We all do, I think, because we come to this planet naked and we live naked. That's, we're alone of our life. We just beside by other people. It goes with relationship. Any sort of relationship, including the workplace relationship. So what they're trying to do for the last 100 years, where they're trying to brand me, to adopt me, to think through the company, and like in Japan, that the only the company matters and nothing else matters. The company feeds you, send your kid to school. Without a company, you'd be dead. That is gone. That is completely gone. So yes, the 4 weeks, 4 weeks or 3 weeks or whatever, whatever days, you know,
it's not
the days, is the time. There is all kind of people on this planet. There's people that cannot sleep at night. They sleep the 8 hours, but not at night. They cannot sleep at night. Well, let them work. There is people like me that don't ask me to be early morning. I will not be there. But if you want to work until late at night, I'll be there. But don't ask me to do at 6 a.m. I'm not a morning person. Never was. And never will be. But by all means, if you want to kick the gym at 5 a.m. and then punch a bag at 4, by all means, I'll be in bed. You know? But, and there is a room for everyone on this planet. It's time we reshuffled not only our thinking, also the resources. Doesn't it call human resources at the end? But then use that. Use the resources you have. Question number one, what you can do, who cares? Where you live, who cares? What you look like, who cares? If you're a man or woman, who cares? First question, how long or when can you work? At night, during the day, in the morning, what is the best time for you to work? You have kids, you rather work in the afternoon because the kids are in school? Perfect, I will make a place for you. And then I will recruit other people in the morning because you cannot work in the morning. And I will have a team. Isn't that what the point of recruitment is? That will work perfectly in harmony. We will be happy to work because they have the time slot that they want with the job that they want and the culture they want, the time they want. The one size fit all shirt, all XL shirt, wear this. Why should I wear this? It's too big for me. But wear this, one size fit all. We're gone, it's done, finished.
Yep, absolutely. I expect major changes like this happening in the way in the workplace as we move into the future. And I think this was all this was coming. 2020 and COVID just acted as a catalyst to the whole process and kind of fast forwarded life and workplace into what we are talking about now to actually reach us much more earlier than what it would have actually been. So
perfect. I'm happy with that.
Totally. I'm sure many people would join you in celebrating. And I'm sure that the workplace are definitely going to be very, very different as we move forward in the future. In fact, I think if I can say that, it would be even unimaginable and unexpectable as we know today how the workplaces may shape up. In fact, if you can shed some light from your crystal ball as to how do future workplaces are actually going to look like, would love to have your inputs on that.
And I don't need a crystal ball. We already know what's coming. It's called AI.
Yep.
And there's no soul on planet can hide from it. Do you think those people have spent billions of dollars just to showcase a cute little robot of the World Tech in Las Vegas? No, that's not why they put $10 billion in research. It's not to amuse the crowd at a conference. It's because it's coming, and it's coming sooner than we thought. Not in the next 20 years, not in the next 10 years, in the next couple of years. I give you confidence here. Something that I met one of the head research of Amazon, one of the biggest company in AI because they have the money to do that. And she's American and she was based between America, between Seattle and Vancouver, where I was living and from. So I met her by chance at the hotel. It was a conference and she was next to me. So we talk. And then we took the talk away from the conference and we talk about AI only because she was the head of research for AI. And that's about 3 years ago already. And 3 years ago, she said, we have 5 years. So if I'm good in mathematics, minus three, we have two years left.
Okay.
All right. So, and AI is not this. It's not Siri or whatever Google thinks equivalent is. That's not AI. No, AI, the real AI, those we can program itself. When this happening, we that close, where all the coders in the world, and that Jack Ma say that from Alibaba, stop learning coding because tomorrow they will code themselves quicker, better, and no mistakes. So we don't need all these coders anymore. All the people in IT that make huge money right now, at the minute the machine can do it, what are they going to do with these people? Compete with what? Compete with force in a warehouse with all the crane and robot that can handle things faster, quicker, nonstop without blinking an eye? Cannot compete with that either. So what can we compete with? The only thing we can compete, the only thing that makes different from a robot, don't try to be a robot. Trying to be human, because anyway, we won't be a robot. We won't be a cyborg either. But what is to be human, really? Is to bring the emotion, is to bring what make us, is to bring all of our culture and mix that together. It's like a potluck. It's like bring your best dish and I bring my best dish and we have the best meal in the world. This is what to be human is all about and being creative. At the moment, those AI won't be that creative. They will still what they create within the parameters of being at the moment on version one. Of course, maybe in 200 years from now, who knows? But at the moment, no. We cannot compete with that, so we don't need to compete. We need to create our life. Since we're changing everything, let's change that too. let's not try to compete with a machine, because in certain things, in calculation or in execution or in coding, you won't be able to hold on the pace of a machine ever.
Absolutely.
Google a few years ago, and they didn't really talk about that too much. They plugged the AI, it was in machine learning. They actually plugged the machine learning, so that they teach a computer to do something. And then they plugged to a computer that never heard of that task and watch how this computer number one, that knew how to do the task, will teach computer number two. And as soon as they connect, the computer number two said to the computer number one, can you talk to me in the language I understand? What is this kind of thing? And that was the latest Python 3 or 4, whatever we have now, the latest coding thing that human being can come with. When the two machines talk to each other, the second machine, like, what is this language? What is this? Can you, they recreate, before we do anything else, the two machines agreed to create a language that can talk, a language machine, what they call NLP, a natural language programming machine language, you know, and they start talking so much that it was the matrix for the engineer at Google. They couldn't follow what they were talking about. They were so afraid of what's going on next, they unplugged the whole thing. We're still in time, we still can unplug them. Within minutes, they create a new language. So they can do the task. So this is what's happening, what's coming to us. And there's no soul on earth. It's like a meteorite coming to earth. There's nothing, no soul on earth can hide from it, because they don't want to change the thing, and it's coming with us. Which is, again, we can see the half empty cup or half full. It's not necessarily maybe a bad thing. Maybe it's time finally that human beings do something else. I mean, the only time where people have, in the history of at least the Western world, where they have time to think was the Roman and Greek Empire, because they didn't do any work. They had slaves, sadly. But those citizens of Greece, the citizens of Rome, that's where all the philosophy of the Western world come from. Why? Why now? Not after? Because it was the only time they didn't work. They had time to think, and they come with all this philosophy. The work was handled by other people, but sadly was human slaves. What about if, for the first time in the planet of history, machine really do what we're supposed to do, and we have time to do something else? Become philosophers, artists, other things. And lead to the machine something better than us. Maybe it's time that we do something else that we've been doing. But that's my hope, and that's a prediction. That's my hope, and not a prediction. That's my hope for the future. Maybe I'll be dead by then. But hopefully we will all come together. Because I will finish with that sentence. Everyone has been to space. I haven't been to space. But for everyone to space, when they look down to Earth, they only see one globe. You don't see the border anymore. You don't see a flag anymore. You don't see a regime, and even less a company logo on top of the building. You just see a blue planet. And nothing else around, at least for as long as we can know. So let's be it. Let's be that blue planet.
Absolutely. Very, very, very well said. And I think you made such a great point with all this coming up. And hopefully it's all for the better, right? And we'll move in a much more fast forward fashion. Things will get automated. We don't really know how things are going to turn out. But I think what we can do is ensure that whoever is in university today, whoever has passed out, students or entry-level freshers or even professionals, I guess what they start needing to do now is to start getting prepared for the next world coming up. And, you know, that kind of brings me to my last question to you is, with all the, you know, you talked about artificial intelligence, with AI coming in, with blockchain and 5G and extended reality and others, now moving at a pace which is so unexpected, what do you think are the key skills which will need to be focused on by students, by graduates, by freshers, by professionals, for ensuring that they stay tuned in to the requirements and possess the required credentials for getting hired and moving up the ladder, or even starting out as an entrepreneur, you know, starting your own business and scaling the business rapidly forward? What do they need to really harness themselves or equip themselves with to ensure they don't get beaten in the race?
So in terms of skills, since not even the industry will know what kind of job will be created, I won't be even like speculating on this, because I don't know, they don't know, no one knows, and especially school even less. So no one knows what's going on. So whatever you learn today, knowing that a part will be useful and a part won't be useful anymore, And whatever the skills are required on the future, we will find out when we cross that bridge. Don't concentrate too much on trying to guess or second guess or triple guess what skill going to be needed. Concentrate on what you can do from already today. Being a human being, as again, you know, that means if you want to be a leader, if you want to be things, you need to learn something about leadership that maybe the MBA doesn't teach. Elon Musk say, no more MBAs, right? That's what Elon Musk say recently. I don't want to hire more MBA because I don't want another smart pants tell me how to economy. Look, I've been doing economy with 5 or 6 companies. I don't need to be told what to do. What I need instead is a human being with me that is creative, open to change, and adaptable. Not someone that come with a theory from a book that I read 25 years ago. So need to be adaptable and need to feel the change. I'm a psychologist, I'm in a good place because the minute I interact with somebody, basically I say that in a funny way, but when I'm not in my shower by myself, I use psychology. Because the minute I get out, step in my shower, I'm going to talk to someone and then psychology starts. Whether I buy a coffee at a coffee shop, which is a very short interaction, or whether I work deeply in a project with someone all night, I will need psychology at home, at work, everything. So knowing psychology, because it's the knowing how the brain and how the mind function, knowing how make a stick for sales is good, for any kind of things we do is good. Sales will still be there because whatever we do, we're just producing. So the sales are safe for now because it's based on the economy. You know, we produce, we have to sell it. So you have to be salesman. And but then second thing is like be compassionate. Trying to understand what it is to be in the shoes of somebody else. That is gender equity. I mean, you know, that's something that we're still battling on most of the planet. You know, we know now, for example, Scandinavia, again, and most of Northern Europe, all those prime ministers are women. The prime minister of Norway is a woman, prime minister of, they're all women. The prime minister of Finland is a woman, of Denmark is a woman, you know. Right. Angela Merkel, prime minister of the chancellor, which just resigned, but was a woman, you know, for the last 15 years. And those countries, by chance, doing better. So, just saying. And we have Trump, and you can compare if you want. And he's a good economist. You know what he's talking about when it comes to business? He's a fantastic businessman. But Finland do better. And Finland doesn't have the resources that America has. And Finland does better. Now, my favorite in women leadership is actually New Zealand. Jacinda Ardern, Prime Minister of New Zealand.
Absolutely. My favorite too.
If one day I can meet her, I will hug her just to be there. I'm not just New Zealander, I've never been there, but I mean just there. We need people like that, but not only women. There's also men like this, obviously. You know, it's time again, we leave the old war between the macho things and unite, because men are also capable, same as women. It's time to let the women talk more, and it's time the women to also stop the who is the best at whatever it is, stop comparing and use the creativity. We all have a human brain, men and women the same. So use the creativity. Maybe women are more in tune with their feeling and emotion. The men have been too worried about who's the best. Forget all that and use the creativity. So both men and women use creativity, be human, be compassionate, trying to learn a bit of psychology because we're going to interact with people and know the culture. Finally, I will know the culture because the world is mixed and will be mixed even more. So you don't do business if you take these two extreme, but you don't do business with a Japanese businessman, but then you do business with a Saudi businessman. The sign, well, actually, it would be almost similar in some way, you know, but there is some code and seal sign that belong to the culture, that if you don't know the culture behind it, you will insult them. You give a business card to, you take a business card to a Japanese person and you do, you do like in America, here, my business card. Forget, business finished. If you leave it on the table, also finished. You handle the business card and he handle yours and you study it. Make sure he show you and make sure he see you studying it. And then you bounce very low to saying, and you put in your shirt, not somewhere at the back, that you will really hold on to it. You might have a chance to do business with the Japanese. You do anything else, forget it. So there's a culture and everything, both men and women, things and culture that we have to be learned. The world is being become one big place, merging, hopefully in my vision, merging. However, we don't have to lose our taste and our culture. That's what makes us human. All the colors and all the panels are unique. They've been created and bred for so many years. I don't want to lose those. Let's not lose that. Let's not make one culture. Let's keep those culture. It's a chance. But let's learn it. Let's know how to use it. I had my friend from Saudi Arabia that had lived with me. He made kapsa. I hope I say it well, the national dish of Saudi Arabia. You know?
Kapsa, right.
Yeah, with the mountain of rice, with a mountain of chicken, and everything's the size of the country, mountain of something. I loved it, you know, very, very, I loved it, you know, and I've never been to Saudi Arabia, at least not yet. It's still my friend and he invites me, so I hope I'll be there. But all this region, but it's fantastic. And I made Norwegian salmon, which he never had, made by the Norwegian cook as a Norwegian way. Because maybe he had salmon before, but not the way the Norwegian does it. And so that exchange was just that. Let's do like a meal, you know, that's the thing. So for the skills, don't worry so much about the skills. Skills can be learned. What cannot be learned is if you're flexible enough and if you, you know, you can learn something. What is need to be learned more likely is to adapt to the new workplace, to the new thing, the new interaction. And that we never put any emphasis into the human interaction, only on skills, especially the last 50 years, we're trying to compete with machine. We ask the free language secretary to be a free language secretary. The French is free tongues, but the only tongues he used was to put the stamp on it, you know, which is a waste of time completely. So don't use someone with a skill if you ask to do something else with it. And let's be, as I say, compassionate, more human, and understand each other. And for that, you have to know a bit of the culture, a bit of the psychology, a bit of travel. If we can afford to go from home and travel, go and see the world, at least for a little bit. You won't see the whole world, I doubt it, me neither. But see what interests you. Know something, and know that's completely different. Like the discussion we had prior to this live, I live in Thailand now, and I came to see another way. And it's not only for me to see another way, it's for me to see how I, the white guy, react in this culture, to see who I am when I'm not in my culture, and how I'm going to adapt, and how adaptable I am. This is also not only to see something new, it's to also know yourself better. You only know yourself if you challenge yourself. If you don't challenge yourself, stay in the same culture, you only know who you are in that culture.
Absolutely. Very, very well said, Patrick. I wish I could write down and record every word of that and frame them and hang them on my walls. Very, very well said. The gist of it is I'm a doctorate in business administration, and I realize now that the future of work, as you say it, is not necessarily the science of business administration. It's not. It lies in the complex understanding of the meaning of what it is to be a human being. It lies in the understanding of what it is to be compassionate. It lies in the understanding of culture across barriers. It lies in the understanding of really what, how do you really make the other person feel? And I think very well said, nowadays, more than trade, more than your expertise, more than your specialization, what you need to invest more on are these skills. Understanding human beings, understanding culture, having compassion.
Sorry, no, carry on. Sorry.
No, go ahead. I was summarizing whatever you just said.
No, absolutely. Thank you so much. But you're a salesman, right? So you come with two products, similar products, they're all good, same price. Who are you going to buy from? A one you can connect with, or one just because the product is good, or even better? You will
absolutely the one you can connect with.
More.
Totally.
Exactly. You rather pay more for a lower product than to pay less for a higher product because you can stand that person.
Very true. Very true. Very true. I have a few questions here, Patrick, if you don't mind, if you're not getting too late, shall I put them up?
Yeah, no worries. Of course.
Okay. Let me select who's here. There's a question from Conan. He says, it seems 2021 is another year of new developments and disruptions. What do you suggest to the companies to respond to so that they not only survive, but thrive?
I don't know if they're going to thrive yet, but surviving maybe. To be honest with you, they're not on thriving. First of all, let's remind, they were not thriving before COVID. They were forcing, you know, as I said, there's two ways to make you do something. Okay, count on, if I say correctly. I don't know you, but let's say we meet face to face. And first time ever, my first second interaction with you. And I'm asking you a favor straight away. A favor that you don't want to do because it's kind of complicated. And you don't know me, so why should you do that? I've got two ways to make you do it. I put a gun on your face and you don't want to die, so you do it immediately because you don't want to die. Or we become best friends. That would be much longer time. But then you would do the favor immediately because you're my best friend. So what you invest into is time with the people, right? So the company have been disrupted, you're right, and they're about to survive. They're trying to survive the same, unfortunately, many are trying to survive the same way they have built a business with, which is no longer valid as we just talked for the last an hour and 20 minutes. I don't think the rules apply anymore. So forget thriving, we're surviving, but they're trying to reimpose from home the same thing we're doing at work. It cannot be that way because if everything's changed, everything's changed, not only the chair, you know, it's not the sofa, it's more comfortable. It's the way of working is different. So first they would have to accept that to trust the employee because basically what I'm getting at, many companies don't trust the employee and many employees don't trust the boss either. So there's non-trust relationship where everybody's doing it for the money, and they're looking for a way out. The boss trying to fire the guy and the guy trying to find another job as they're working together. 80% of employees of the planet constantly looking for another job, even if they have a job. That yep. says a lot. That says like no one is satisfied with what they had. It's standing there. So thriving will be a time where 80% of people don't want to ever change a job again because they're satisfied with the deal they get. At the moment, only 20% have that. 80% looking for the way out. So thriving, forget it. We have to change anything. But surviving, yes. How they can do that? Well, they could possibly start trusting. To trust, you have to care. And for caring, before trusting, you have to care and respect. Respect, caring, trust. First, you respect someone. If I go to my coffee shop and I ask politely a coffee, I might get served. If I say something very not present, they will kick me out of the coffee shop and never serve me again. They put me on the red list. All right. First interaction is politeness, respect, the first thing. And then it's caring. If I go every day to the same coffee shop and I start talking, I start caring. How was your exam? I will say to that lady serving the coffee. How was your exam? Oh, you're doing good? Oh, great. And then maybe become my friend. And then one day, hey, you know what? I'm going to go for 2 days. Can you look after my car? I will keep my car the parking lot at the back. Can you look after my car for 2 days? Here's the keys. That's trust. So first, respect and then caring and trust. The workplace haven't worked that way. Most people didn't even respect each other. Forget caring and forget trust. That's why they were working for the way out. So to thrive, you have to be in a trusted environment. Not only trusted as a person, but also trusted. What does it mean, trust? It means like, if I do mistakes, you ask me to do something, and I messed up completely. You say, Patrick, that's okay. You're a good person. I know you didn't do it on purpose. Let's learn from it, and let's do that again. Then I know I can make a mistake again, because your reaction. If I do a mistake and I get fired, immediately, without question asked, I will not even try to do the mistake. I will not do what you ask for, because in case I don't know how to do that, then I will save my job first because I have a family to feed. So I won't take any chance. I won't take any chance. I won't be creative, even if I think I can do. But if I think there's a mini chance that I might fail, and then if I fail one time, only one time I get fired, I won't take a chance. So all the creative in me, you won't see it. It's time for the workplace to trust the employee.
Absolutely, very well said. And I think, and as much as employees, as much as organizations can start doing that, they'll realize that they will actually start thriving, because when the employees start thriving and the employees are treated well, exactly, then that's when you really start. That's a starting point of success.
Why you want to leave a company that gives you everything you ask for, money-wise and all the things? You don't want to leave them because you know that out there, sadly, you've been searching all your life and you know there's not so many. So when you find one, if one become clever here, that say, okay, let's, okay, what do you want? Okay, forget the old management thing, school, forget all that. What do you want? You be happy with that? Okay, you get it. Then the person will stay and your investment will be beneficial, you know, because for any company to grow, you need someone to stay at least a minimum. You invest in some person's skills. If the person stays 6 months, you won't be have a time to harvest the skill of that person. 6 months and is leaving. The turnover in America is a year or less. Who can ever thrive with that?
I can totally relate to that. I've been working for my organization, for example, right now for more than 8 years now, almost 9 years. I've loved every bit of it. And one of the reasons why I stuck around, although I had many other opportunities much better than these ones, because the way the organization treats its people, treats very, very well. And you know, that kind of resonates very well with me. And I'm sure it does it to everybody, because as I was growing up, I was taught by my parents and by my religion as well to treat people well, be compassionate. The first thing you do is be compassionate to people, have integrity, everything else will fall into place. When you really use those two as wheels, compassion and integrity as your life guides, I think life generally becomes very, very easy for you, not just at a professional front, at a personal front too. So thank you for all that wisdom, Patrick. Lovely, lovely words shared. I am very, very grateful to you. The audience has loved it. Let me just share a few comments of gratitude. So here's one from Ishaq Amir, says, totally agree on connecting.
Thank you, Mohammed.
And Fazila Hussain is from South Africa. She says, thank you for a very informative session.
Thank you, Fazila.
And Conan here has a big thank you note for you. He says, my takeaway is automation becomes more useful and usable in real world conditions, work will become more focused on human abilities and needs. Very true. We need to continue to promote well-being, think in terms of competencies over processes, and use technology and our human skills to the best possible advantage. Thank you, Omar and Patrick, for a powerful session on such an important subject. You're welcome, Conan.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And we have Muhammad Hanif from Kuwait, who says a satisfied life is much better than a successful life. The parameters of success is your own heart and mind. True that.
Well said.
Okay, and then let me see if I have, there are many other comments, but I'm sorry, everybody, I can't really put everybody's comment on. We are overextended on time, but it was an absolute pleasure.
Well, I can see the wisdom is there. All these people and all of you couldn't mention, you know, we are human, we have the wisdom. I mean, if I can say what I can say, I mean, I'm just another guy. I'm just another guy. So everyone can find the same thing, you know, and I'm not nothing special. We have a little wisdom. I really agree with most of you. And let's remove the middleman that forced us to not do that. And let's do business together.
So we have lots of other comments. We finally have this one. Treat people well is the best way. Absolutely. Great. Thank you. Thank you very much once again, Patrick. Lots of gratitude to you. Words of wisdom. This session is live and will be also be available as soon as we end this on Facebook, on YouTube, for anyone who wants to access them and have a relook at them or share them with anyone you know. Please feel free. And Patrick, I might connect back with you again. We definitely want you back on board sometime because you have so much to share. Absolutely.
And I talk a lot. I talk too much sometimes, but I like to talk. So.
but here's the thing. Everything you said was nuggets of wisdom. And I think everybody lapped it up and they are sure to enjoy it and gain a lot of learnings from it. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you, everybody, for listening and being there. Thank you, Omar, for inviting me.
Thank you. The live is now going to get ended. Thank you, everybody, for being there. Thank you, Fazila, and thank you, everybody, Muzammil and everyone, Ammar and Shima and Amir and Khan and everyone who was here. It's been a pleasure to have you ask questions, to have your feedback. Every session like this, every speaker needs an audience, and you've been a great audience. Thank you very much, everybody. The live session now gets ended. Have a great day.
Have a great day.